The objective today is to explain what Boolean logic is and why it is helpful. So it's the end of the unit project today, meaning you're going to have some creativity opportunities. We'll start class with a quick review just to get you grounded in Boolean and what that means again. What we have not started is coding on the circuits that we've created, so that is totally possible. We just currently do not have the resources for that. What I mean by that is we don't have breadboards and wires and Arduinos. These Raspberry Pi type computers that we could connect to the circuits and create stuff. So, you know, hopefully that's going to be something in the future I'll have. Currently in progress, just understanding Boolean logic and all the variety of ways that logic can be used. And then completed is connecting the wires together with transistors to create these gates. So, Boolean, as in Boolean search or Boolean logic, where does the term Boolean originate from? Well, the guy's name is George Boole. He's a 19th century mathematician. And essentially, his ideas led to the world's first computers, whether we're talking about 1937 with Howard Aiken being inspired by Babbage's analytical engine. This guy persuaded IBM to fund a huge electromechanical computer programmed with punch cards. We've talked about punch cards before. And this whole device, it was called the Harvard Mark I. As in Harvard, the college. And then you have the ENIAC, which was invented by Peter J. Presper Eckert and John Mockley at the University of Pennsylvania. And this began construction in 1943 and was not completed until 46. So we're talking at first the 30s and then the 40s when computers made their first appearances, and they are using George Boole's logic to do so. And if you notice on the right-hand side here, I have a Mark I in terms of Iron Man's first suit. Now, relay switches were soon followed by vacuum tubes, and then smaller transistors, and finally microchips, with ever greater levels of miniaturization. Computers, information storage and retrieval, electronic circuits, controls and sensors, and much of the world of technology that supports life, learning, and communications in the 21st century depend on the inventive, versatile mathematics devised by George Boole. We sort of owe it all to him. Now, my think, write, share here is, why can't I have you guys create microchips? Really? What's stopping us? So I told you all this history just to say that you'll see some of this in JavaScript once we start that unit. If you can't wait to get started, go ahead and follow this link. And essentially, you'll see the use of AND OR gates inside the code itself. And it says here that the Boolean value of an expression is the basis for all JavaScript comparisons and conditions. So let's get to the end of the unit project. At this time, we're using the evaluating portion of the International Baccalaureate rubric system. And so students evaluate a solution. You have 4 points to cover. First, design detailed and relevant testing methods, which generate data. That's the key right there, generating data, to measure the success of the solution, and critically evaluate the success of the solution against the design specifications. The third one is explain how the solution could be improved, and the fourth one, explain the impact of the solution on the client or target audience. So here's the setting the stage for you. Software and hardware engineers alike have heard some form of this advice. Build lots of prototypes, iterate as fast as you can. So for those of us in the hardware industry, these prototypes can cost a lot of money and time. So while we should strive to iterate quickly, we must also get as much information as possible out of each round of prototypes to inform improvements of the next iteration. So what we'll do here is we're going to imagine the creation of a website, and that's going to be our prototype, okay? And what we're doing with this prototype is selling hardware, such as PlayStations and Xboxes. Essentially, the website, which can be coded up in JavaScript, will take information from the customer about the types of things they care about in a gaming console, and then create a determination, so create a solution for that customer based on their input. So we'll start with that step one of extracting data. So let's create this chart in Canvas. You can do the insert table to create this. We'll talk about RAM, graphics, processor, and bandwidth. Memory bandwidth, that is. So to start, the PS4 reserves up to 3.5 gigabytes for its operating system, leaving developers with 4.5 gigabytes. How much total RAM does it have? 8 gigabytes. They can sometimes access an extra 1 gig of flexible memory when it's available, but that's not always guaranteed. And at this time, I can't really tell you when the memory is or is not available. For the Xbox here, the guaranteed memory amounts to slightly higher than 5 gigabytes for developers. This is gaming developers, as Microsoft's multi-layered operating system takes up a steady 3 gigs. So my first think right share for you is which system has the most guaranteed RAM, and then I want you to jump to your chart and go ahead and fill out those two boxes for the amount of RAM. Don't forget to put your units of gigabytes. For the next box, here we go, the difference between resolution is the difference in the amount of pixels being used and the amount of animations that can occur per second. So here I want you to think of picture details versus smoothness when going from one picture to the next. So as a reflective think right share, what's the difference between FPS and resolution? This picture does a great job at showing you the difference between two types of resolution. Here you have 1920 by 1080 pixels. Here you have 3840 by 2160. And you can see the amount of detail is significantly greater here compared to over here. In terms of what are we going to write down in our chart, well, the PS4 games achieve up to 1080 resolution at 30 or 60 frames per second. And so you would write that 1080p and then 30/60 FPS. Now the Xbox runs at 720 or 900, depending, and at 30 or 60. So the frames per second is the exact same, but not the resolution itself. And if you're sitting at a computer right now, one of the desktops from the school, it's a really square machine, and I have a VGA cable connecting the monitor to the computer itself, so you're looking at just a box like this. Now, if you are using the school's laptop, you're getting more of a 1600 by 1200 type of resolution because obviously you got a wider screen right there. So on this slide, it's not even really a think right share, just write down the resolution in FPS in your column. Alright, now to the processor. Both the original Xbox One and the Xbox One S has a custom 1.75 GHz AMD 8-core CPU. So the number you're writing down is 1.75 GHz under the processor row. Now the PS4 clocked at 1.6 and contains a similar custom AMD CPU with what's called x86 based architecture, and that it's a very, very common architecture actually. Everything from Android phones to the computer you're watching this on very likely has this x86 architecture. So think right share right here, which CPU is faster, and then I want you, of course, to write down the gigahertz under the processor row. Now memory bandwidth. This may be the hardest one to wrap your mind around, but I feel like at least this is just another data point for us to go ahead and extract and look at. So memory bandwidth, essentially it's the rate at which data can be read from or stored into a semiconductor memory by a processor. I mentioned semiconductor because we just spent the entire unit studying transistors and talking about memory in that sense. So the PS4 CPU and GPU, they both have a bandwidth of 176 gigabytes per second, while the Xbox One, not even close, has 68. So to really wrap your mind around this concept, think of memory bandwidth as, the more the better. And a video card with higher memory bandwidth can draw faster and draw higher quality images. So you're going to get a mixture of better resolution and frames per second with a higher bandwidth. So essentially our next steps is to actually learn JavaScript so we can create this website. In the meantime, here is some reflective think right shares to wrap up the whole lesson. I want you to critically evaluate the success of the solution this website offers to people. So your think right share here, if PlayStation is clearly the better console, why do so many people buy Xbox? Now say your website is up and running. After the client clicks on the items they care about, that is the graphics, processor, RAM, bandwidth, and don't forget price, explain how the solution that is your website could be improved. And here's our very last one. Explain the impact of the solution on the client or audience. So you're thinking about what personal or societal impact will this website have? This is a website for people to understand and learn more about the hardware of these two gaming systems and then offer them the opportunity to purchase one of these from you. So basically, what's the impact that such a website will have?